Welcome to the world of coral reefs. These incredible ecosystems are home to millions of fish and invertebrates that find protection and food sources within the reefs. But not only are they one of the most biodiverse ecosystems on the planet, they are also one of the most sensitive to human activities. In Aeos, one of the 600 islands of Papua New Guinea, the members of the community have a very special relationship with the surrounding coral reefs. Over the years, the community established an interesting informal arrangement. All year round, they can only do line fishing. This arrangement has led to a sustainable management system where the reef ecosystem can thrive and provide enough resources for the community. Unfortunately, not all coastal communities have such a healthy relationship with their surrounding reefs, as economic circumstances often push them to overfish or mine the reefs to sell them as souvenirs or use their limestone. In some cases, like in the Spermonde Archipelago in Indonesia, there has even been blast fishing, best described by Jordan Hollersmith, a marine ecologist and researcher at Simon Fraser University.
There occasionally is blast fishing going on, which is where fishers come in, deploy bombs in the water, the bombs explode and stun all the fish rise to the surface so they can easily be grabbed, and the coral is left destroyed. This was mainly being done by outsiders coming in.
But there is another way in which humans have indirectly harmed corals: climate change. The oil industry and the large developed countries that have burned fossil fuels for decades have dramatically increased the levels of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, gases specialized in trapping heat, which in turn increases the average temperature of the planet, including that of the oceans. If you've heard the term coral bleaching, this is basically what happens. Corals turn white as they lose the algae that provide them with their beautiful colors, but more importantly, with their food. The desolate cemeteries of white corals throughout the world show the extent of this issue and how it keeps spreading as temperature rises. It's estimated that the acidity of the ocean has already increased by 26% in the last 100 years, and it is estimated that this has damaged more than 30% of coral reefs worldwide. In addition, many of these species are fished and are a source of livelihood or income for local fishermen. Like Dr. Hollersmith puts it,
thinking about these small island communities, there's no farmland on these islands. They're atolls. They're incredibly densely populated. All of, or most of, the protein and income comes from fishing and the surrounding reef.
This problem is exacerbated by the dynamics of supply and demand, which means that in the absence of supply, fish prices increase, and industrial fisheries extract more fish from the sea than is sustainable, making the problem even worse. And if that were not enough, losing coral reef structures would also mean increasing the impacts of storms and hurricanes that enter the coast, as they usually serve as a barrier that protects coastal communities from these extreme events. So, as we can see, this can get really ugly if we don't do anything about it. But where to start? Is there hope for corals? Well, there are a lot of initiatives and community management schemes, like in Aarhus, that are looking to protect or regrow coral structures, just like the one Dr. Hollersmith was involved with.
So together, these three groups, UC Davis, Hasanuddin, and Mars, came together to create this kind of innovative approach to coral restoration that was centered around building these modular framed structures that could be built cheaply, involve local communities, and then be placed out onto the reef really quickly. And then we would attach coral fragments onto those structures. And since the structures allowed for ample water movement all around the corals and also elevated them off the bottom of the ocean, so it was harder for predators to access them, those two in combination seemed to make them grow incredibly quickly, to the point that in a lot of these sites, when we would come back a year later even, we could barely see the structures at all, and it was completely covered with coral.
That's a very inspiring story. However, she also gives us really good insight about what still needs to be done.
To solve those problems, we need to go to the source. We need to reduce our emissions. We need to fertilize less and control our own human waste better. And reef restoration in the methods that we're currently deploying it is nowhere near the scale needed to restore reefs at that level. Capitalism is the root of a lot of environmental problems that we see now. Are just our current setup of society is based on extraction, on haves and have-nots, based in inequality. And so even the protests that we're seeing in the US right now, that is also connected to all of this. To fight capitalism and to save the coral reefs means also lifting up oppressed people, sharing power, and getting rid of white supremacy. It truly is all connected.
Thanks for tuning in for another episode of this climate justice mini-series of Planetiando, the coolest blog on planet Earth. Make sure to like, subscribe, and share. I'm Greta Gledhill. See you in our next video.